rundown of some of the things that your students are going to do when they are in kindergarten through second grade for literacy and then for math. So we're going to start with arrows. You should be able to just hit enter and it should go to the next slide. So there are five components or five basic parts of literacy. There are phonemic awareness, phonics, fluency, vocabulary, comprehension, and then we also put writing in there, which doesn't go along with the reading part, but does go with the literacy part. So those are the five things we're going to talk about tonight and explain a little bit about what they are and what we do with them.
Should I go back?
No, go forward, please. Nope, go back. There you go, Mrs. Benson.
Oh,
it's you.
So kind of, especially in kindergarten and moving on to first and second grade, the phonological awareness is a real important part to a prerequisite to reading. The better they are at these kinds of activities, the better readers they're going to become through rhyming and wordplay. And you know how well they do at those kinds of activities, blending words, segmenting, adding words, deleting words, that's a really good indication of their reading success later. There's a strong correlation if they have those basic skills, they're going to be better readers later. What we do in class for that is we have a program that is strictly for that. And the kids every day in kindergarten, we call them reading exercises. I don't know if you do the same, but every day we just have a short 5 to 10 minute thing on touching on rhyming or segmenting the onset and rhyme. Kind of goes like this. We show them flashcards. We go through the whole alphabet and we say letter is A, sound is A. We just keep going. Right now they're all in order, so we'll mix them up. We do a rhyming thing where we put thumbs down if it's a rhyming word, and we just go really quick. Right now we're working on compound words, so I'll say like cupcake to the kids, and they go cupcake and put it together. Or I'll say cupcake, and they have to split it apart. Or we'll add words. If I say we have snow and storm, what word is it? Snowstorm. If we take off the storm, what do we have left? Snow. So they're adding and deleting, and just a lot of wordplay and things that we do every day.
And second grade and first grade also do this, and it just builds on the skills that they do and goes further into it. And one thing that you can do to help at home is if you have not been a nursery rhyme reader to your child, that is super important. It might not seem like it is, but all of those nursery rhymes that maybe you learned as a kid, students really don't know now coming in, and they really should. So you could get a nursery rhyme book. Tommy DePaula has a really good one. That would be something you could be doing at night with your child. Do that.
And that's because it rhymes, right?
It's the rhyming and it's the wordplay, and it's more hearing the sounds, like it matches, some of what we do in our book matches the sound with the letters, but the phonological awareness is more hearing the sound and being able to hear that there are three sounds in a word or four sounds in a word, because that's a building block to what we can move on to in phonics then. And if they can't hear the sounds, it's very hard for them to put them together in words later or to spell them in words later.
That's an important part. It's all auditory. Phonological awareness is all auditory. We don't say ball begins with a B. We say ball has a book at the beginning. So
our next component is phonics. This is something you're probably more familiar with. This is actually matching the letters to the sound. So knowing that the k sound can go with the C, or with the K, or knowing that the F goes with the B instead of the D. What we do for this in class is we do a lot of what we call word work. It's what we use instead of the traditional spelling that the kids do. So we do a lot of word sorts and different things like that, and it's called Words Their Way. So you're actually going to do that now. If you work with people at your table, you all should have some of these envelopes at your table, so you can work with someone or do one by yourself, however you want to do it. So this is an example of something your child would be doing in school, starting more in first grade than in second grade. This is actually than in kindergarten. This is actually a second grade sort. So first graders work a lot with matching the picture to the word. So there might be a picture of a cat, and they have to match the cat to the picture. Second grade moves more up into, there are different spelling expectancies. Some people call them rules, but think of them more of expectancies because English always breaks rules. So your job is to take the words from the envelope. You should have three headings in the envelope that tell you what the categories of the words are, and an oddball. And we're going to do a very quick, what we do with the kids at the end of the week after they've been doing these is a quick 1 minute sort. So you're going to get 1 minute, and you have to sort the words into categories with the headings at the top. So it's probably easiest if you look and you find the headings in there first. So the headings are going to say things like CVC for a consonant vowel consonant pattern, or CVCE as a pattern, and then CVVC. So those C's are consonants, the V's are vowels. So those are the patterns you're looking for in the words. Are you ready? The kids love this, by the way, because they only have 1 minute. So, ready? Go!
Once they really know those letters and sounds, they can identify them more quickly in text. We want them to be able to do that, so when they come to a word they don't know, they can sound it out quickly, read the words correctly, and use punctuation the right way. So if kids are more fluent, like right now in kindergarten, we'll be working on letter fluency, just getting them to say those letters mixed up really quick and know the sounds really quick so that they can then, you know, be more fluent as they're learning to read and sound out words. And first and second grade, they want them to, you know, have those basic sight words and know those word patterns and things so they can look for chunks and figure those words out.
It takes less of your brain power if you know those sight words. That's a whole chunk of like 250 words than that your kids don't have to stop and try to sound out or figure out. And a lot of those sight words are eyeballs or rule breakers where they don't follow the rules anyway, so they're almost impossible to sound out.
Right.
So it just helps them so that they're worried about the words that they don't know and they already know this chunk of them.
So the way we work on that is our book bags, which we have from kindergarten through second grade. They contain sight word lists to be worked on, maybe word family lists sometimes, just other things, plus a level reader. That is an independent level for your child. Your child should be able to read maybe one mistake or something, but be able to just fly through that and practice that book so that they feel really good about how they're reading it, and it should just really flow fluently. Those book bags need to come back every day, even though we don't necessarily use them every day. We just never know what day we're going to get to that child or stuff, so that should just stay in the backpack all the time.
And if your child brings a book back and they're not reading it fluently, so they've taken it home, they've read it to you, they practiced it, they come back, and maybe they've made 10 errors, you're probably going to get that book home again for them to practice for something. Or it could be if they're reading their book like this and there's no expression to their voice. That might be something, too, that they might get the book back, because even though they know all the words, part of this fluency is using their voice, because it would be really super boring if we all stood up here and talked to you like this all night long. So that's one of the things we work with the kids when they're doing their fluency. So vocabulary is hugely important. Little kids don't always have a big vocabulary. One of the words that second graders were learning this last week actually was litter. They had no idea that litter and garbage were the same thing. So going through and learning words and upping their vocabulary so, again, they don't have to think about what those words mean as they're going along is something else that they work on during the year. First graders will be getting, eventually as we get started, a vocabulary envelope where they'll be putting words in, and then they'll bring that home to you, and then you practice reading those words with them and also having them explain what the words mean. So, like, if they have the word litter in there, they would pull it out and they say, oh, this is the word litter. This is what it means. And you can discuss that with them. That discussion is really important with you, for them, with you about what those words mean. And if you have questions at any time, you can raise your hands and ask if there's anything you need to know.
Now, this year we implemented a new reading series for our curriculum. It's called Benchmark Advance. It has all the components of balanced literacy, and it does a really good job of incorporating all the comprehension and fluency and vocabulary and all those skills. It has a lot more nonfiction text, which the kids get really excited about. The students can work more on connecting with the text through some vocabulary and annotating, and the kids are doing a lot of annotating. Well, kindergarten's not yet, but we'll be. First and second grade already. We're still sitting. But we have texts that we look at, and we just found all the words that start with M because we were looking at M. So we looked through some texts and circled words that started with M. We found words to underline too. We found where we had our favorite line of the poem, and we put an asterisk by it. You can also put a smile face. So kindergarten kind of does this kind of annotating, just looking for simple things, just getting them used to looking more through the text and at the text.
And first grade kind of builds on that. It's the same things that kindergarten can do. But we work really hard on sequencing the events or putting the events in order because that retelling like that is important. We work on details and finding important details in the text and underlining words that maybe they don't know where that vocabulary comes in, or sometimes they're asked to underline something in the text that means something else, like underline a word that means the same as trash, or underline an idea that tells about one way that you can help your community. That was one we did last year. So all of the annotating is building up to, they do a lot of this kind of thing when they're in high school. So they're actually starting now, something that they will be doing in the future in high school. And Mrs. Enholm, maybe you can talk about how the second grade one is a little bit different.
Okay. We've been working on using certain symbols for things. On the sides of, they have little magazines, they're paperback, and they're supposed to mark them up. If they're reading something and they don't understand what it is, they're supposed to put a question mark near it. If there is a certain word they don't understand, they put a question mark by it or maybe circle it. If we're doing sequencing, like if I said, you know, what's the main idea of this paragraph, that paragraph, that paragraph, you know, the whole article that we read, they'll find, you know, this is what happened first, and underline it for a little two or one by it, and then two, and then three. They just use a lot of different marks. If it's important, we've also used highlighters with it. If there's something that they want to remember, else they can use your highlighter, and you know, this is an important detail. So again, it is helpful because it helps them identify what are the key features of what they're reading.
So this is the part when you get to your child again. You have a packet like this at your spot. You can do this on your own or with a buddy if you would like. So this is something that the first graders will be doing next week. So there is a poem. Usually what we do is we read this together a couple of times, and then they go through and do the annotating on the bottom. So I don't think you need it to read it with me. So I'm going to let you read it yourself, and then you can do the annotating that's on the bottom, and the directions are down here. But we're going to do a really short version and give you like a minute. Go. Your kids will be doing at school. You can pass these around to look at later, but this is a sample of the first grade book of what we're doing now at the beginning of the year. We have a sample of that. This I'll pass around too, but this is a sample. You can see they're getting more wordy on the page, and there are more things that they have to do on the page as we annotate. So I'll pass this one around and you can kind of look. And then this is second grade book, and this is the first one that they're doing
second
now.
So this the first one, no, the first one they're doing now.
Second grade
yeah.
book that they're doing. Yeah. So the only other thing
they haven't seen that one yet.
Before we go on, of course, the math is a big plug for my special needs shirt that I want to make, which is Read More Books, which means That's where your kids, 20 minutes of reading at least a night, every night. Sometimes that'll come home from school. If it doesn't, whatever you have around the house to read. And also, that goes for you too. So you know that your kids see everything that adults do. And kids are mimics. And so if they see you reading, they're more likely to read. If you're groaning about reading or you don't want to read, they're going to kind of also take that on. So even if you're not a reader, just make it till you make it. Pick up the book and act like you're reading.
Oh, I was going to say, does online reading count? Because I read a lot.
Yeah. Online reading is great as long as you tell them that you're doing online reading and that you're not reading Fortnite.
Okay.
Because when they see anybody doing anything on a computer, they think it's Fortnite. So it's a game. I really know nothing about it other than that the kids are obsessed with it. So, but like right now in my room, my Hino board, I have to go and reset every day with this, these things I have to tap every day. And the kids think it's a video game. Right? It's really not a video game. It really means our board's not working the way it should. But because it's on the board and because it's on the computer, they think it's a video game. So if they see you on your phone, they're probably going to think that you're listening to music or playing a game. So you kind of have to point out to them, I'm reading the newspaper, I'm reading my book that's online. You know, something like that is helpful to them.
Do you have a preference of us reading to our kids or having our kids read to us at their level?
Yes.
Okay.
The answer is yes. They should be doing both things. All the way through at least fourth or fifth grade. And
oh,
if you have
absolutely.
Older kids, they're going to argue with you, but just you have to keep doing it. There is one study that actually says the most important thing you can do for your child and their SAT scores looking into the future is to read aloud to them. And so that kind of falls with you as a parent to read aloud. It's really super important. Audio books in the car, maybe instead of the movie in the car or the video game in the car. I'm not a big video game fan because I want to read the books. But I get it. Video games are easier and helpful to them and they enjoy them. But yeah, keep reading all the way through.
Parents, sometimes I've met parents who have said, well, now that they know how to read, I don't have to read to them anymore. And I'm like, no, that is not true. Please read to them. Because, first of all, it's really a special time for you, you know. And secondly, you can read these great books and enjoy them with your child. And, you know, it's just really a good opportunity for them to increase vocabulary and your modeling expression and all that other sort of thing.
And you can read things to them that are harder for them that they might enjoy that they wouldn't be able to read to themselves. I mean, a prime example is a lot of parents start with, like, Harry Potter books before their kids are actually able to read them because the kids enjoy them, because it also increases their level of reading. And that is the ultimate goal, is that they love to read, they're going to end up doing more of it. And on to math.
For the next slide. So we're going to kind of walk you through the each of the skills at each level. Oh,
why is that?
I don't think we had it all the way up in
9 minutes. It probably just needed to be
on view.
Can present.
Going to talk about is whole numbers, and in kindergarten we're really working on that one-to-one correspondence. We're already doing a lot of that counting and matching the numbers, ordering, and we'll be comparing here later this week, comparing numbers greater than, less than, equal to, and then moving into the number operations. So we're talking about adding and subtracting. We'll do that all year long now that once we get those introductory numbers down, we'll be moving right into adding and subtracting and teaching them the introductory level of those strategies that will lead them to...
So I don't know if we were doing whole numbers. It just progresses as they move on. We just finished up our whole numbers chapter in second grade through 1,000 and higher. You know, depending on your child's exposure and ability, you know, some of the kids are just mastering, you know, what numbers in the hundreds are and learning hundreds place and, you know, 237 to 337 is, you know, 100 more. Some kids are beyond that and ready to learn how to read numbers that are, you know, 542,869, you know, and, you know, I show them things like that, and they just practice. Patterns are still very important. It helps them recognize things that they're going to get in the future. Skip counting, not just by twos or fives or tens, but skip counting by threes. That eventually leads on to learning their multiplication facts. Number operations in second grade throughout the year, we will get to two and three digit addition and subtraction with trading. One thing I want to point out is that I think is extremely important. I was talking to my students today about this. How many of you think adding is easier than subtracting? And many of them said yes. And I was trying to say, well, by the end of the year, I hope you're not going to say yes. Because if you understand that numbers have a relationship with each other, adding numbers and subtracting numbers within the family of numbers should all be the same. I was going to do an activity, but I think we're running out of time. So I'm just going to do it big on the whiteboard here for you. For example, you can see if your child ever shows you something like this, I just want to explain it to you. There's a triangle with a dot on it, and give me any two single-digit numbers. Okay, let's say 9 and 7. Put those in the corner. This is going to be an addition or subtraction fact family triangle. What goes up here? 16. I have fact family triangles, flashcards. So if I hold the flashcard like this, they know they have to add those bottom two numbers to get the answer. If I hold the flashcard and cover up this, then it's a subtraction problem. And then they can start to realize that this is just all connected. And oftentimes we'll have four equations underneath, two addition and two subtraction. And they have to write down 9 plus 7 is 16, 7 plus 9 is 16, 16 minus 9 is 7, 16 minus 7 is 9. So they learn to recognize how those things work. So we have different strategies for learning facts, which you may or may not have heard of. Things such as doubles, doubles plus 1. There's even one called Kirby numbers. 3, 5, and 8 go together. And 5, 8, and 13 go together. Those are kind of Kirby numbers. So all of that helps them to remember things. So some of these strategies that are okay, using your fingers really is okay if they are still at that point where they need something physical to show. Manipulative drawing pictures using the numbers grid, hundreds chart oftentimes we use to show, you know, the relationship between numbers going up by tens. You don't have to change the ones place at all. Mental math, counting on, tally marks, number lines, number sentences, which we call equations. So.
Okay, she just talked about the mental arithmetic, and included in that is estimating. So this is really hard for kindergartners. They just want the answer. We really work on that a lot throughout the year, estimating with word problems and other things. Patterns, we've already done that. We'll do that all throughout the year, sorting and classifying. And then algebra comes in with the addition and subtraction. So it's all that baseline level that we're teaching them in kindergarten so that they can build on that in first and second.
Yeah, and in first grade, as far as the algebra goes, it would be like filling in the blank, you know. In second grade, they can actually learn how to use balanced equations, such as 9 plus 4 equals blank plus 6. You know, and at first when they see that, they don't get it. And then I said, well, that equal sign, it's like a balance scale. You have to make sure that this side is the same as this side. And as soon as they see, okay, then I can go from 9 plus 4, that makes 13. So what plus 6 is going to make 13? So they can figure that out. One thing I do want to show you about estimating quickly, there is something called a rounding wrap that, gosh, Mr. Miley, maybe you should
I just want to show you that kids, you know, estimating can be a really, really hard concept for children. So let's take this number